रिपोर्ट स्टार्ट।
या
You want to try sharing your screen or?
Yeah, I'll be sharing my screen. Yes. Shall I experiment with that?
Yeah, maybe.
Can you see my screen now?
Yeah, it's fine.
Okay, I think we'll start. I'm very happy to welcome Professor Rajiv Tarandikar. He was my colleague at the Indian Statistical Institute, Delhi, for many years, more than 20 years. And already there, he had started doing things which normally professors do not do. Namely, he started providing the theoretical framework for analysis of elections, opinion polls, exit polls, etc., to some television channels. From ISI, he went on to some business company and then came back to academics. He was the director of the Chennai Mathematical Institute for 10 years. Very happy to welcome him to Ashoka to give a talk. Welcome, Rajiv.
Thanks, Rajendra. And very happy to be giving this talk at Ashoka. I've been associated with Ashoka in various activities. Though, of course, last 2 years, I haven't come there, like not gone anywhere. But earlier, I have made visits to Ashoka. And know several people there, so very glad to say this too. So today I'm going to talk about opinion polls in the context of Indian parliamentary democracy. So the title itself, I'm making it very clear that I don't claim to be an expert for elections across the globe. It is focused on Indian parliamentary democracy. And as Rajendra mentioned, while at ISI itself, I had started doing this. So in fact, I was in ISI till 2006, and I started this activity in 1998, early 1998. So already 8 years while being at CMI, at ISI. So what I'm going to talk about, one is a question which I've been often asked, that is, how can obtaining opinion of, say, 20,000 voters be sufficient to predict the outcome of a country with over 83 crore voters? So this 83 crore voters was the number from 2019. 2019 Lok Sabha election, there was actually 83 crore voters in the election commission list. We will also discuss, this and also issues involved in cephalogy.
Rajiv, there is a problem with the sound somehow. Can you make it better?
Okay, just a
minute. There is an echo and not very clear.
I hope it has improved. It's a fan.
Okay.
Yeah. And sometimes the sound on the other end is, it's a lot more than what I can hear here. So whenever this has happened, I've changed the fan and then things have improved. So thanks. Yeah. So, so I'm also going to share my experiences over the last 20 odd years. Okay. Another important question that I would like to address is, do opinion polls conducted well ahead, say a month of the polling date, have predictive power as far as final results are concerned. So, like in Punjab, elections are going to come up sometime next year, and already people are saying that, okay, things are close, and they'll start doing polls and going to the television channels. But my view is that such things give an opinion of best it can do is the opinion of the state electorate at that point of time, not necessarily what will happen in the final results. But this is something I'll again return to. Now, for any such activity, one must put down what is the objective. So when it is Lok Sabha poll, do you want to predict all the 543 members of parliament who are going to get elected? Is that the objective? If that is the objective, the thing which will be required is very different. Whereas, of course, when these people ask you to do things, they don't have any objective in mind. So we have to set our own objective and tell it to them that this is what we are proposed to do. So the nationwide opinion poll in India, the objective that we had put down is the number of seats for major political parties in the parliament. And seats, parties or alliances. Okay. And more importantly, the question, which party or alliance will be the maximum number of seats? And if will this number cross half may mark? So typically, who is likely to be the largest is generally known to people. They may not accept it openly or in the TV channel, but outside everybody would know. They'll grant that, yes. So like 2019 or even 2014, that BJP and allies, NDA, they are going to be the leading group was understood. So that was not a surprise. Though earlier years, it has been a surprise. But at that time, that was not in question. The question was, will that number cross 50% or not? And if so, by how much? Will it be the party alone crossing 50% mark, or is it only the allies which will cross, etc., etc.? And the same applies to opinion polls conducted across elections to the state legislature. Okay. Now, in particular, over the years, I have been questioned by many, including some who have had MSc in statistics, that after all, even 60,000 would be a tiny fraction of actual number of voters in India. So again, 2019, actually 61 crore voters voted. Over 61 crore, 61.4 something crore voters. And even if I had 60,000 sample, I've never had analyzed anything with 60,000. But even if I had 60,000, that is 1 in 10,000 or 0.01%. How can this tell us anything about what is going to happen in the country? All right, so. Now, what is the probability and statistics background required? And if all of us were physically in Ashoka University, I would have done something different. I have been doing something different, but since we are all working from home, I have now come up with a second best option. So I'm going to, this was the talk I gave in Google London about 4 years ago. There are many such in the YouTube, but I picked this one and I'm going to play a clip from there.
Deliberately, I've kept it blank. It doesn't mean no background needed, but we'll do it live, what background is needed. So what I have with me is just a cardboard box, and what it has are 100 slips of paper, okay, identical in all aspects. And each one has a letter written on it, either A or a B. So you trust me on that. And then I mix them thoroughly and come to the audience, and someone whom I have never met before, I ask you to pick up one. You can pick from the top, bottom, anywhere.
Okay.
All right. Can you read out and?
Yeah. A.
A. So you believe that we have not fixed this event, and one was drawn out of this box after mixing, and that one read an A. Now, it's just based on this information. If you were to make a call, I forgot to say that there are 99 of them which have one letter and exactly one which is an outlier. Okay. So either we have only two possibilities, 99 A's and one B, or 99 B's and one A. Just based on this observation that it was one was drawn out after mixing, etc., etc., and that was an A. If you have to make a guess between the two possibilities, which is the likely possibility? 99A and 1B or 99B and 1A? 99A. So, few people answered, others may have made up their mind but didn't answer. But
so when I have given live talks, this is I actually carry such a box and do it, and I've done it several times. And A, B, 7, 8, something, something. So, but 99 of one type and one of the other. And invariably, of course, everybody who guesses will guess as the, if A has been seen, then the answer will be 99A, 1B. And if B is seen, 99B and 1A. And this has invariably happened. Okay. Now, if I ask the person who has made the guess, what went on their mind? Why did they say 99A, 1B? Well, the answers can be very different. If they are depending on, if they have had statistics background, their answers will be of one kind. Some will simply say, what is there to give you a reason? Isn't it obvious? Isn't it common sense? Starting from here to statistical techniques, Bayes theorem, whatnot, lots of things will come up. But invariably, the answer is this. So, without going into why, actually, you can do the if you want to do probabilities, you can do probabilities of the two events and two conditional probabilities and so on and so forth. So, if you believe that there is 99A and 1B or 99B and 1A, one is drawn at random by the audience, and if it is A, then the guess will be 99A and 1B. Okay. This is about all the probability statistics background which is needed in opinion polls. Essentially, something very little is needed more, but that's about it. Okay, so now let's move it a little. If instead of 99-1, okay, 99 having 1, etc., suppose it is the split is 95-5. 95 have one letter and 5 are the other. This time, instead of one draw, I do 3 draws. I go to one person in the audience, let them take it out, let them read it out, put it back, I mix it, go to another. So I do it 3 times. And now when you do it 3 times and not 2, 3 times you are assured that either all 3 will be the same or 2 of them will be of one type and 1 will be of the other type. If there are only 2, then you can't really say which one is what. But so if I do it 3 times, the rule of the majority, namely, if all 3 are A or 2 are A and 1 is B, you say 99A, 95A, 5B, and the other way. Whichever thing is larger number, you go with that as your prediction. And this time you can compute that the accuracy is still 99% roughly. So it's like the old picture. Okay. And if instead of 99 and 95.5, the split is 90 and 10, well, we can still reach 99 accuracy if we draw larger number of slips. And how many you need to draw, you can compute fairly easily. Okay. So the crux is that if you repeat the experiment and you then apply the rule, majority rule, you can still more or less simulate the same thing what happened in 99.1 case. Okay. So now, let's say we go to a assembly constituency, say 1 lakh voters. And to make matters simpler or simple, suppose there are only 2 candidates, A and B. Now, as mathematicians, we have the luxury of supposing. So suppose we make all possible lists of N voters, where N is an odd number. Take a number N and draw lists of all N voters. So we have lists. Now each list, if we can go and speak to this, let's say this has been done just after the election or the day before election. And if you can catch all the voters and ask them, and if they are telling you the truth, you can figure out that on that list, which candidate has majority. You still don't know what is in the overall 10 lakhs, 1 lakh voters, but that list, who has the majority, you can tell. And so now what I've done is I've given a list of what percentage of lists have candidate A having majority. The column, this will be the next page. The column header is a percentage of support for A, and the row header is the list number of the lists, size of the list. And this is, I've done it with a Python code rather than doing through any other applying any probability techniques book. Okay, and here is the so this is percentage of people in the constituency which support A, and this is the size of the list, and amongst the list, how many lists. So if 55% support candidate A, then even when we have a list of size 751, over 99% are showing that A is the winner. Because our rule is majority rule. So if we apply majority rule, how correct you will be, accuracy. So that could be other way of saying. So, and if it's 54, still 1000 will give you 99%. And if it's 53%, you, at 1501 will still be at 99, and so on. Okay, so this is what I meant by that instead of 95-5 or 90-10, even if you have here 55 means 55-45 split also, by the time we reach 751 out of 1 lakh, we can still pick up the correct winner with a large probability. So if the winning candidate has at least 54% votes, that is, it is not a closed election, then if we take n to be bigger than 1001, our 99% is achieved. Okay. Closer 1501, then 94% will achieve. So this is telling you that out of 1 lakh, size of 1500 will still do, even if it is 50-48. Of course, let us, just for clarity, that if it is 50-50, no matter how large you keep going, it is going to remain at 50. Okay, so this is not magic. Okay, but you are not going to be able to detect exactly. So, all right. So
the percentage doesn't matter. The percentage of the winning entry in the sample you pick.
Sorry?
So you pick a sample of 1000, and of that 1000, 55% are saying A. That doesn't matter at all. Just the majority matters.
Majority. Who is the majority? Yeah. So if our 55 here is the number, a percentage of support in the overall population of that constituency. And if 1001, even if 5001 tell you A is winning, you will say A has won. Okay. So that's the idea. And this you can compute a very simple Python code, one can write that. Okay. Now, more important question now is, what if the total number of voters is 5 lakhs instead of 1 lakh? Okay. Suppose winner candidate is still getting 52% votes out of 5 lakhs now. What we needed lists of size 1501 to ensure 95% lists have the correct winner. Now, what do we, since this has scaled up by a factor of 5, do we need to change 1501 to 7505? Namely, should the sample size or list size be multiplied by 5? This is what a lot of common people believe. And but as mathematicians or people having had it, we'll know that, okay, it could be you have to multiply it by 5, maybe you have to multiply by square root of 5. Who knows? Scaling is at the root 5 level. Okay. You will be surprised at the answer. The answer is you don't need to increase it. 1 lakh to 5 lakh, the this picture will be the same, whether it is 1 lakh or 5 lakh. And it's clear why. Because out of 100 slips, if 95 and 5 was the split, this one gave us the accuracy. Okay. Now, if instead of 100, we have 1 lakh, 95%, 95.5, our ratio will be this. Every factor in every term gets multiplied by 1,000, they cancel out and the ratio will be the same. So, if indeed it is 95.5%, whether it is 100, 10 lakhs, a million, just a sample of size 3 will give you the correctly, and likewise for a higher sample. Okay. So 1 lakh to 5 lakhs, no, you don't need to increase. Of course, in practice, you're never, this one is what is called sampling with replacement. Namely, if I'm drawing from the box, I take out one, we read it out, mix it, put it back and mix it and then draw the second. Then these are the probabilities. In practice, you can't be in sampling. You cannot be going to people and you go to someone. You say, "Arey, you came yesterday and you asked me." You say that, no, you appear twice in my sample. He will say you are crazy. He'll throw you out, right? And it's a waste of time for you. Energy, effort, money, everything. So this is with replacement. And what is the picture without replacement? Without replacement is, so if you draw 3 times and we do with without replacement, then all possible cases are 1,99,998, and here are the 2 cases we can put down. And actually it has goes up slightly. So in practice, you do sampling without replacement. But if the sample size is fairly small compared to the population size, making this difference doesn't do you much gain, little gain only. And you can as well do quick computations involving the sampling without replacement, with replacement. So candidate with 52% support. This time, my percentage support I have kept fixed, and the population size I am going starts from 10,000 to 50 lakhs, and list size I've gone from 400 to 4,001. And what we see is that initially the things seem to go down a little because 401 is a large section here. But by the time you reach whatever 5 lakhs here, or yeah, the change. 5 lakh to 10 lakhs, 10 lakhs to 25 lakhs, 25 lakhs to 50 lakhs, the numbers don't change much. Okay, so this is the fact that when the sample size is a small percentage of the population size, it really doesn't matter. The population size doesn't matter. You quickly just compute what is this. So point is, sample of size 2,500 will do for over 97.5% already here, and 4,000 will accurately do it at 99.4% across the board. So, and it's not going to change if 50 lakhs becomes 1 crore. Or so, sample of size 4,000 out of 1 crore is still going to give you, if you go with the majority rule, you will be right over 99% of the time. Provided the election is not very close, that is there. Okay. So accuracy is determined by the list size and does not depend on the population size. Once the list size exceeds a certain percentage, this is something which even people who have MSc in statistics, and after years of this, they lose this aspect and they've argued with me. Others, of course, argue with me. And this was big in the argument for the EVM VVPAT controversy that erupted in 2019. What Election Commission had proposed was very reasonable, yet there were court cases and media going crazy. And anyway, today I'm not entering that. All right. So the point I've tried to illustrate till now is that by choosing a large sample, one can ensure that in most samples, over 99%, the winner in the sample is also winner in the constituency. Thus, if a large sample is chosen at random, we can pick the winner 99% probability. That is the message I conveyed just now. Of course, but the selection of the candidate, selection of the sample is extremely important. The word random there is extremely important. And the thing is, in colloquial English, the word random is also used as a synonym for arbitrary. Is also used in the sense of arbitrary. And before anybody argues with me, why do I say so? Just look at what does RAM stand for in your memory on your phone or on your computer. RAM stands for random access memory. So here it is actually, this was to differentiate it from something like a tape recorder, where if you had to play the fourth song in a list, you have to go through 1, 2, 3 till you reach 4. You can accelerate that move, but you have to go through 1, 3. Whereas on a CD, you can straight go to the wherever is the fourth one. So it is arbitrary access memory. But whoever coined this phrase, they thought that random and arbitrary are the same. So they said random access memory. Okay. And this is the crux of a lot of arguments people have had with me. So, and failure to do sampling randomly, you can get wrong results, completely off the result, because the statistical guarantee that the real proportion and the proportion seen by you in the sample are close to each other, that comes up only when you have random sampling and not pick up people just as the wish. What I used to call old days, that is when I started doing it, I used to call it going to a city and going to a pawn shop on a busy intersection, a corner thing, there will be a pan ki dukan and a lot of people are coming and stopping there. You just talk to people who are stopping at the pan ki dukan and get their view and declare it as a random sample. You may be right, but you can be completely off the mark. Of course, as time has changed, the pan ki dukan has lost its relevance, but now it is malls. You know, if you want to do sampling, where you can quickly do 500 group sample size by just going to mall, 2 or 3 malls you choose in the city, and one day you would have sampled 500 people. But that won't do. Okay. And there are many instances where wrong sampling, not doing random sampling, you can be completely off the mark. Sampling is also tried out in US particularly by telephones. You randomly call people, you draw a number at random and then call that person and then ask the opinion. I don't believe in that. And certainly 20 years ago in India, this would not have worked. Even though the telephone density has gone up significantly, now I guess in India, it has crossed 80% or even 85%. Total number of telephone connections divided by the population. But as several of us have 2 or more connections in our family, we'll have number of connections will be more than number of family members. Each one has a mobile. Some have 2 mobiles. Then you have a landline and so on and so forth. That tells you that this 80% number is still a misnomer. It's not that 80% of people have access to phones. Okay. And so phone sampling will not work. A method used by almost all agencies which do opinion polls in India, okay, they are market research agencies, most of them, and they use what is called a quota sampling, something which I was never taught, or at least in my presence, it has never been taught in ISI as what is quota sampling method. But it's commonly used by market research agencies. And what it does is that some things available with in public domain, you will have the proportion of population on gender, rural, urban, last census data, whichever is available. Based on that, all this information will be available. So you try to do is you pick, let's say you want to pick 1,000 people, you pick 1,000 people in a state, let's say, then such that the male-female proportion in your sample agrees with whatever is there in the state in the census, rural, urban, education, caste, religion, etc. And you believe that if you have matched these 10 attributes, if here I have listed only 4, you can come up with 10 which may be relevant to election. And if these 10 things match, then lo and behold, the 11th one of interest will also match. But that is a hope. There is no guarantee that it will match. Okay. So unless you have randomized sampling, this will not work, may not work. Fortunately, I got involved in this whole thing while I was approached by CSDS, Center for Studies in Developing Societies in Delhi. And the approach incidentally came through another colleague of mine, Professor Bhaskar Datta, who is now at Ashoka, at least 6 months a year. He had visited CSDS and they asked him that, you know, we are going to be doing polls and we want statistical advice. And he came and asked me whether I will be happy to do it. And I said, yes. At that point of time, I was out and out theoretician, only theorem proof mathematician or a probabilist, not even a statistician. But I got involved and I enjoyed doing it. And I hope results are good, but more than that, I enjoyed doing it. Okay. So, in my view, the statistical guarantee that the sample proportion and population proportion do not differ significantly kicks in only when you have picked the sample randomly. If you do not do randomization, you do some purpose sampling. No. We know the thinking. So we will figure out doing it much better. Our sample will represent the population much better. I let them say it. I don't argue with them, but I know that what they say is not true because in some elections, they may be right. And some elections, when they are wrong, they will be awfully wrong. So the random sampling method costs a lot more than quota sampling. But this is a must. And by a lot more, by what order it can be. So during the years I worked with CSDS, 10 years period, 2000 till roughly 2004 to 2014. Earlier off and on, but in that 10 year period, we continuously worked together. The CSDS is a public entity, government institution, and they are trying to only cover costs. The other market research agencies are doing it for business to make profit. And yet, the quote from CSDS used to be 6 or 8 times more than the quote from the market research agencies. Okay, because the cost is more. And well, so till now, roughly half an hour gone, and I have been able to convey that following proper statistical methodologies, one can get a fairly good estimate of proportion of votes of a major parties at the time the survey is conducted. Here it comes that we can do it only at the time survey is conducted. If survey after that 2 weeks are left, 3 weeks are left, we can't really say how the mood will change. Okay. But public interest is not in percentage of votes. So you turn back in 2019, if somebody could have predicted the percentage of votes correctly for the parties, the people will say, who cares? They want to see who is winning the election. Right? So public interest is in prediction in number of seats, not the percentage of votes for parties. And this is where I focused a lot. And indeed, by the time the period I mentioned, 2005 to 2014, with CSDS for CNN-IBN channel, by then we had already worked out various parts of methodology. And so formally speaking, on paper, I was only responsible for vote to seat conversion and CSDS was responsible for doing the sampling. Of course, they were doing it on agreed methodology that we had agreed upon earlier. And my analysis, I will share with them, and if they have, I'll convince them first and then we'll go to the news channel. That's what our method was. So before anybody thinks, you know, why can't there be a simple formula that if you have percentage of votes, then you should be able to say percentage of seats. Well, it is possible, though extremely unlikely, even in a two-party system, that a party A with just about, say, 26% of vote wins the majority whereas the other party with 74% votes may not win the, they will lose. And this can be if over 50% votes in 272 seats, winning that those seats, and the rest 100% goes to B. It is extremely unlikely, but possible. So it's this overall percentages won't give you the number, how these votes are distributed across the seats. Okay, that is important. And usually the team, the party which gets the largest number of votes, they also get the largest number of seats, but the ratios may differ. Though during this period that I have been involved, two, three situations in India, not Lok Sabha, Vidhan Sabha, twice consecutively in Rajasthan, in Karnataka, BJP, Congress got significantly more votes, but BJP got more seats. And at least one other state, probably one of the Rajasthan elections, the same had happened. But I may be off here. But Karnataka, I know for sure. Of course, US, Hillary Clinton losing in 2014. No, sorry, I'm missing the date, year. But anyway, Hillary Clinton losing to Trump. She got more votes, but Trump was the president. So this can happen. Just to predict number of seats, we need to estimate not just percentage of votes in the for each party, but how they are distributed across. And here comes in all kinds of interesting mathematics, statistics issues, and past what data is available, how do you use it, so on and so forth. And also presence of independent small parties, they also influence the election, and they can also have a role in doing this vote to seat conversion. So before I go to vote to seat conversion, if I have a random sample of size 4,000 in each of 543 constituencies, then it's possible that each one I can, with high probability, predict who is the winner and add that together, and I can predict overall fairly quickly and correctly. But 4,000 in 543 will mean over 21 lakh respondents. And this is very, very difficult. Time, money, reliable, trained manpower. Even if somebody gives me the money, and I get 21, I get for 21 lakh, this thing, I will need at least 5,000 size manpower who will go around. And if I have to do it in quick time, I may need 10,000. How can I ensure that none of them are doing something? What is the worst thing that can happen? My worst nightmare would be if somebody actually doesn't go and do sampling, sits at home and writes down the report and gives me that I went, did his sampling, this is the report. So even if a few people do this, then the whole exercise has gone for a toss, right? So reliable manpower is the very important. And even if I have money, I don't have time and I don't have reliable trained manpower. Not that I have money. Okay. So this resource is impossible. Various people over the years have claimed very large numbers, but they are not forced to declare when was the sampling done. So the last 6 months, whatever sampling they have done, they can add it together and then they say our thing is based on 5 lakh sample size. But whether the sample from 6 months earlier has any relevance today or not. So one thing is that in India, they have laws covering so many things, though they are not, they may be violated, but at least we have laws. In this election business or opinion poll business, there is no law. I have a name over 20 years. I have been doing it. Today, nothing prevents some agency, one of the news channels to just give me money. Say you come here and you say this is, you did sampling and this is the result. Okay. I may, the whole thing can be a hoax. No, I'm not answerable to anyone as to where the sampling was done, when was it done, what was the sample size, methodology of analysis, nothing. I don't have to reveal anything. I can just go and make claims. Okay. I'm not saying that this is what is done, but there can be lots of shortcomings in what part they are selectively telling us. like when they say 10 lakhs sample size, this is the first thing which comes to my mind. When was the sampling done? Or was it really 10 lakhs? Or anyway. All right. So, now, another thing about India bashing, that, and people said that to me. This was late 1990s, right? So this is not that the first times opinion polls are happening in a country. After all, in the Western world, they've been doing it for donkey's years, 50 years at least. So why can't you just go there or get from there what they do and just do it? Why are you saying that you want to do fresh research, you want to do this, that, et cetera, et cetera? Okay. So first time I did it, various parts of the things I was doing it, some was for India Today, some was for Doordarshan, and there was significant money available, not to me, but to spend properly. And they had flown in Professor Clive Payne, a statistician who is a cephalologist in UK with a track record of over 20 years doing this for BBC of UK election. So I'm reaching that level now, 20 years and more, but he already had it in UK and it was doing it all along for BBC. So I spent 2 full days, each day about 8 hours or 9 hours, talking to Professor Clive Payne. And he was trying to tell me what is his methodology. And he would ask me questions about what are the Indian reality. And I would convey to him the Indian reality. And at the end of 2 days, we concluded that his methodology, we will not be able to use in India. And that comes as a surprise because after all, the Indian system is essentially the British system. Okay, constituencies and first pass, whoever gets the largest number of votes in a constituency wins. And then they go to the parliament and there they elect the prime minister, right? So everything is basically borrowed from the UK system. US is different. Some other countries have different systems, but ours is same as UK. But our conclusion was we can't do it there. And there were many reasons, but I will just list two. First one was that if I call volatility of public opinion, borrowing a phrase used by finance world, volatility means, let's say from last election to this election, what percentage of voters may be changing their opinion, assuming that the same parties are continuing, not like a new party has come up or whatever. Okay. So what percentage of voters will keep vote the same to the same entity they voted last time? That is percentage change is what I'm calling volatility. And so at least in that time, the volatility in UK was extremely low. I've heard now that over the years, things have changed quite a bit in UK also, though volatility may be far less than in India, but at that time it was almost, so Clive Payne said that, if you know about me, that I'm a professor with such and such university, and just this information is enough to predict that my entire family is voting Labour. Okay. In fact, he went on to say that the biggest scandal that in my family I can get is if I hear that my daughter has gone and voted con, that is conservative. So that is the biggest scandal he could think of in his family. So that is how stable the intentions there were. I'm told it has changed even there now. But in India, with parties changing alliances and leaders changing parties, every day we get so-and-so is switched or so-and-so is thinking about switching, as is the news just now. Why would we expect that the voters will be loyal to the party that they had voted last time? Indeed, not just over a five-year period. In fact, as the election comes close, the volatility goes up. That is my assessment. And based on a few data points that we have, we can conclude that indeed that is so. And that was one reason why the methodology from UK we cannot bring here. Volatility. Other things is availability of data. There at each constituency level, they have the socioeconomic data available. Constituency level, in fact, every booth. Whoever are the voters there, their socioeconomic profile will be available. In India, socioeconomic profile is available at a level of district, and a district and a constituency are not the same thing. Okay, so from there we cannot really compute the thing at a constituency, leave alone each booth. So these two things meant that his methodology goes off and we have to start afresh. So what do we do? So we have to understand what kind of data is available, what is the reality, you know, and based on that build a model. So in India, we can have, we have now election data electronically available. In 20 years ago, it was difficult to obtain, but now it is very easy to obtain. In fact, the best source is a website at Ashoka University, which has all the election data, actual results available. Okay, that's at Ashoka website. I forget the exact, but you can figure that out. So I tell it to wherever now I give a lecture that this is the best website. But will the data from 52, even 57, 62, 67, coming all the way up to 1980, will that be of any use? The ground reality is the public sentiment has changed dramatically from then to now. In fact, other than the last election, maybe last two elections, rural data is of no relevance, as far as I think. Then we can build a model for voter behavior, not individual, but constituency level or a state level or whatever. Individual level, no chance of doing it. Constituency level or state level, you can do it. But we already, this data is not available at constituency level where we will need to translate that into our predictions. So therefore, again, not much point. And we came up with, and essentially others do the same, but I gave it a mathematical framework name that, let's see. And I'm confessing that it's a very crude model, but the crude model that we worked with, we started working with and continue to work with, was the following, that the change in votes, which is called a swing by Pranoy Roy, NDTV, he started calling it swing, change of votes for a party from previous election to this election, or change of votes for a party in that constituency from previous election to this election is the swing. That is constant across the state. If you make this assumption, then we have the actual data of constituency level from the last election. You can get reasonably the percentage of votes for the parties at the state level reasonably. And then you apply this and you would have a percentage of votes for each party in each state, each constituency. This is very crude, but this is something which is doable with available data and the data you can obtain. Okay, because one has to keep that in mind. You can build a great model, but you say data is a data nahi hai. Then what good is your model for such this purpose? It may be good for writing a paper, but not good to do actual work. So we started with models which we can actually implement based on the data that will be available. This was one possibility. And we did what is called backtesting. So if in the past data for which we actually have full data, but what if we had got only this partial data of this kind, would we have been able to do the thing that we are claiming? And we found that this model is reasonable if you want to do state-wise or nationwide predicting the election. Of course, you may be going wrong at a large fraction of actual constituency. Each constituency-wise, you may be off, but totally you may be right. You will likely to be close. This is what I discovered by doing back counting. And then we started using this and got reasonable results. And this is with some tweaks here and there. If the state is large like UP, we can go to the regions there. And in between, we can say that the changes are the combination of change in the state and change in that particular region. Various such things we can, small variations we can do, but broadly speaking, this is the model and it has done us good. So the last question I will, now 10 minutes remaining, the last question I want to address, how do we choose a sample? Because I started by saying that that's the most critical part. If this is wrong, everything is off the mark. Okay. As they say in management, GIGO, garbage in, garbage out. So if my sampling is off the mark, my data will be off the mark, garbage data, and then my output will also be garbage, no matter how good a statistician or psychologist I am. So sampling is most critical. And in, I already mentioned CSDS, but in, now that I'm going to mention it, V, how did we choose a sample? So V stands for CSDS and myself. So they were already doing something. They explained to me what they do, and we tweaked it a little and came up with a thing, and that is what they continued to use. So what is important is, how is the data of voters available nationwide at any given time? So how they, what the election commission will give you, those days difficult, now easy. Sitting at home, I can get all this data nation for the nation. That what are the constituencies? Each constituency, how many booths are there, where they are located, and for each booth, who are the registered voters who are to vote in that booth? A PDF file will be available. So the how the list is available to you is important. And based on this, we first chose constituencies by what is called random sampling method, and then chose the respondents, and then people have to go door to door. Some tweaks here, what is the better way of doing it, etc., etc., but I will not spend time on that. Those interested, if they write to me, I can share, send this whole PDF which has the details. And this full these lectures are there on YouTube in several locations. There are articles written here and there. If you write to me, I can tell you whatever depth you want, I can send. Okay. So we have found that generally we have got a reasonable sample. Just to share the way, first time I did it. So till then I would be teaching things only. And first time I did it, it was for India Today. The first output was for India Today, predicting this based on a sample of size less than 10,000 nationwide. And they were done in such a way that after I get the data, in 24 hours, I have to give them the analysis, because then they have to print and bring it to public, because after that, they will not be allowed to publish. So in 24 hours, we had to do this. This was 1998 February. And so the sampling was extremely important. And so I was coming that with 10,000, for a minute, if we ignore the sampling, the election thing, but we would also have obtained data on their profile, gender, rural, urban, and money, etc., etc. And first thing we tested was, I looked at was, that the profile I got out of this 10,000 sample that I obtained, this was sitting at ISI, Delhi. And the data was given to me. The proportions that we got for each of these attributes out of my 10,000 sample were closely matching the nationwide attributes available with the census data. And that gave me that, okay, there is hope that what I do is meaning. Okay. One more thing. So using this, I would be able to predict, say that constituency wise, who is getting what percentage of votes. And now it comes that if in one constituency, A and B, A is leading, but with a small percentage, just 1%, and C and D, C is leading with a gap of 8%. If the votes are, I get the similar, sorry, in A, my data is saying 50.5, 49.5, and C is 54, B is 46. So it is very clear, whatever methodology I do, that I'll be a lot more confident that C is going to win the election than A is going to win the election. A is touch and go. C and D, C seems like well posed to win the election. So somehow the predicting number of seats, this factor I have to bring in. And there I developed a mathematical form, statistical mathematical way of doing, incorporating this. And that came out as a success. And that is what I have used over 20 years. Marginal improvements, but essentially what we worked out first time. In this part, three of my colleagues from ISI were very much with me. At that time, they had just finished their PhD, but were not quite faculty members. Our PhD students are finished PhD. And Abhay Bhatt, Arup Pal, and Anish Sarkar. They continued to do with me election work for some time, and then they got bored. They said, "Now we are not won't do anymore." I continued to do anyway. So one last first point again. Time is almost up, but so as I mentioned that if we do polls well ahead of time, you will not. The best they can do is they can predict what is the mood of the nation or of the state at that point of time. It may change from then to the election day. Now, to avoid this, the method used commonly used is what is called an exit poll. As the word suggests, it is done when people are leaving their booth after election, and sampling is done there. And thereby, you achieve two things. You are actually catching people who have actually voted, because that number can be between 60-70% at most. If you go door to door, you may be getting answers, but they may not actually be going and voting. So that problem is also addressed. But exit poll gives you another problem, that randomly choosing people is a problem. You imagine if I were to stand in a booth with a list of 100 names out of 1,000 who are registered, there are 50 names. And each one, as people are coming out, I stand and ask them, "Sir or madam, is your name here? If so, I want to ask you a question." What will happen? Nobody will wait. So that is simply not doable. People have some proxies, but we had seen that that doesn't give us a good profile of the constituencies, socioeconomic profile of my sample. So with CSDS, what we worked out is what we call day after poll. Given that we have sufficient several phases of voting and there is a gap between the voting date and actual counting date, if you have to do sampling in one constituency, in one particular booth, we will do it a day after that booth has gone for voting. And we'll go door to door and capture these votes and do it. So that is the methodology we have done. And with that, we have got reasonable results. And so now I will come to just giving what is my track record. So over this 2005 to 2014, 10-year period, CSDS and I were steadily associated with CNN-IBN. Now the channel has changed name. Everything about the channel has changed. But at that time, Rajdeep Sardesai was the managing editor, and he was the one who had engaged CSDS and me. And till 2013, till Yogendra Yadav joined up, he was the face of CSDS, and he's the one, and we worked together. After he quit sampling technologies and went to politics, CSDS still continued for the remaining part. And here is the comparison of what was our outcome, what we went on air with, and what happened. So total elections covered in that 10-year period by us is 3 Lok Sabha elections and 25 Vidhan Sabha elections. And fortunately, since this is not my primary way of earning money, I can be honest and declare exactly what happened. I don't have to market myself. If I have to market myself, then I don't have to say where I went wrong. I can say that, you know, these are the places we got it right and very right, etc. So 4 occasions we were off the mark out of 28. Punjab 2007, we were off the mark. We said very close elections, whereas Akalis and BJP won it hands down. Gujarat, we were 2007 and 12. Both times we said Modi ji is going to win, BJP Modi ji is going to win, but the estimate of seats was off the mark, others were better. And Karnataka 2008 also, we were off the mark. These 8 occasions, we were good. And by good, I mean, we picked the right winner and we were almost as good as anyone else, more or less. So on par with others. And I have a list and it includes Lok Sabha 2014 and various other Vidhan Sabha elections, Lok Sabha 99 and 14 both. Now this 16 times, 16 occasions is what I have listed, that we were very good. Our estimates were on the dot or close and better or as good as others. So if you are on the dot, maybe some others were also on the dot, or you were on the dot and were much better than the others. And I have listed them a lot, and there are the one which was very amusing is the Assam 2011, where everyone else had said Congress is losing and we had said Congress is winning. And everyone included the parties themselves, including Congress party. They didn't believe they are going to win, but they won. We were the only ones who said that they are going to win. And I happened to be in Assam at an ISI function where the chief minister was also present. And ISI director Bimal, my friend, he introduced me to the CM and introduced me saying that this is my friend who predicted your victory. And he says, he said in Bengali, but I'll say it in English. He says, I remember. There were only three people who believed that I am going to win. And he named me, you and Yogendra Yadav. Everybody else believed I am going to lose. And that included his party, his house, everybody. Okay? Because people, generally, that is what I have found, that people mix up the data they get from opinion poll and the expert opinion. And somehow they mix it together and come out with a verdict. Whereas we have said we can be wrong, but we will simply go by what our data says. So Yogendra, in 2011, Yogendra was sitting in Delhi. I was sitting in Chennai at CMI. And we only got the data from whoever we had engaged in Assam. And analyzing that data, we had come up with that they are going to win. Congress is going to win. So, and there are multiple such occasions. But let me stop. I see that there are some chats before somebody answers.
Yeah, we can ask if there are questions.
There's one question which says random sampling with a question mark. So what is the question?
I think that was an answer to something you said right in the beginning.
So Okay, all right. And yeah, Trivedi Center for Political Science, that's correct. Political data. And that center, the data is very good. If that data was available to me or to perhaps not so easy to get in 20 years ago, it would have been very difficult. It would have been much easier if that data were available. We had to struggle a lot to get that kind of data at that time. And
maybe you can stop sharing so we can...
Yeah.
Professor, am I audible?
Yeah.
First of all, thank you so much for this amazing session. Really meant a lot. But I just want to know more from your experience. How was your experience of, if any at all, of in different countries, in different voting systems, when votes translate differently to the number of seats than in the Indian economic system? You know, there's a really famous saying that I did here that it is not the vote that counts, it is the count that votes. And it really depends upon how the votes are counted in proportion to the seats. So how was your experience in these other systems?
Yeah. Your statement when how votes are counted is putting a question mark on the counting itself. Okay. It is unfair, I think, number one. Number two, how are the... votes distributed across constituencies, and then what is the system of predicting the winner or deciding the winner? That is also important. Okay. Yes, it matters a lot. Okay. So in US, as you know, or you may know, that in most, I guess, maybe four or five states maybe have a different rule, but in 45 out of the 50 states, they count the votes for the candidates in this entire state, and whichever candidate gets the larger number of votes, all the votes in that state go to him. So New York and California are two large ones, and they are Democrat, and Democrats can count on those. So Republicans really struggle that what can we do? I mean, these two big things are already with Democrats. Okay. So India is slightly better because it is at a constituency level, not at a state level. And then people can argue, why even constituency level? Why can't you give the votes at the level at which the party got the vote nationwide and ask their number of MPs should be proportional to the votes they got in the. So lots of combinations are there. There are countries with differing systems. Okay. Which is better? Well, we can debate. All I can tell you is that the only time we would have got a stable government in India, if we had a votes proportional to the percentage of votes in the nationwide, would have been maybe 2019 and 1984. These were the only two times where the leading parties or the groups were close to or just across the majority mark. Otherwise, in entire Nehru time, Congress never reached anywhere near 50% votes. Okay. So they would not have, so you would not get stability of the election. Okay. So that is, that has some importance, but one can debate.
Yes, Professor. Thank you so much.
Good evening, Professor. First of all, thank you so much for the very interesting session that we had right now. I'm not a maths major, I'm a pol science major, but I'm very much interested in the quantitative aspects of political science. So that's why I attended this session and I totally enjoyed it. So the question that I had was with regards to independents and smaller parties, the role that they play and how the opinion polls capture their relevance in the, you know, the overall aspect. Because while we are talking about opinion polls, while the opinion polls are being taken on ground, what happens, what might be happening is that BJP and Congress being the two major national parties might be capturing the forum, might be capturing the entire, you know, area. And the smaller parties, which have a significance deep in the roots, might not be getting a representation in that random sampling.
Okay. So two things. One, whether the system is fair to the smaller parties or system of election is fair or not is a different question. And how do they impact my methodology is the other question. I can answer the second. First one is a deeper question one needs to debate and answer, is that what system will give them fairness? Okay. The point is that we have seen in our practice also that the data that we get, answers that people give, typically overestimates the big parties. And even when independents are going to get votes, we don't get that correctly in our data. So we have to use some judgment that, you know, this state, there is a history of independents playing a bigger role. This state, there isn't. So here, it's not just a science, it's an art and science, a combination thereof. And domain expertise. And I had a broad experience, but Yogendra Yadav, with whom I worked for long, he had a lot more of real experience with this. So his judgment, and we would say, okay, our data is going to overestimate these parties. So this much independents are going to get. Doesn't mean they're going to win seats, but we bring that in. So we bring in some expert opinion in our analysis that way.
But okay, thank you so much.
But they do not win much seats, except in some seats you can say, no, this one doesn't matter what your poll says, this one, this independent guy is going to win. He is a Bahubali, and which party he is or he is independent doesn't matter, he's going to win. Okay, there are cases like that, but
yeah. Thank you so much, Professor.